3 of IIHS City Scripts. We are very privileged to have with us noted historian Janaki Nair in conversation with Director of IIHS, Arumar Revi. A little bit about Professor Nair before we begin. Professor Nair recently retired as a professor at the Center for Historical Studies at JNU, where she worked from 2009 until January 2020. She has taught courses and supervised MPhil and PhD theses on subjects relating to the history of law, the modern city, capitalism, women and feminism, and labor and working class history. She has published widely in national and international journals, and her books include The Promise of the Metropolis, Bangalore's 20th Century, Mysore Modern, Rethinking the Region Under Princely Rule, Miners and Millhands, Work, Culture and Politics in Princely Mysore, Women and Law in Colonial India, published in 1996. She has made a documentary entitled After the Gold, based on her research on the Kolar goldfields. She's also a regular contributor to popular newspapers and journals. Over to you, Aro. Thank you for moderating this.
Yeah, so thank you so much for coming in the afternoon. I guess people will sort of filter in over the next few minutes. I think it's really, we're very glad to have Janaki here for a number of reasons. One, of course, is it's, you know, this country has a great paucity of urban historians. It's a very important area, and for an institution that works on urban questions, it's a great pleasure to have somebody who works on, you know, the history of more recent or historical sort of urbanism. But also, Karnataka, at least in my limited opinion, is a state and a culture that is somewhat under-traversed as far as history is concerned. And in a sense, the connection between the two is a very important thing. And, you know, she's sort of done seminal work both in Mysore and in Bangalore. A lot of the research work that we do in this institution is kind of driven by some of the interesting ideas that she's laid out in both her books. So I'm going to ask her to sort of open and lay out some of the ideas that she's dealt with. And of course, at some point of time, she might read from her book, and then we'll pick up a conversation between ourselves and then open it up, because there are a lot of people here who've lived and know and love the city, and she is the historian of the city in some senses. So there's going to be a very interesting opportunity for a wider conversation. We're also live, so hopefully a lot of people outside this room will be able to access the conversation and then come in and, you know, talk to her and pick up on this work later. So Janaki, if I can ask you to kick off, you've got some opening comments, and then we can pick up the conversation.
First of all, thank you so much. It's a great honor and a great privilege to be here. And the reason I'm extraordinarily honored is also because the book is now almost 15 years old. So one would have thought it has been superseded by many other books that have come out. I was this morning at a different book event. I was just saying that my own book is about 15 years old now, so I would have thought it has been really surpassed, because there has been almost a cottage industry of writings on Bangalore, and there has been. So I want to start by saying, you know, looking back on this period that has lapsed since I wrote this work, and also my experience of teaching a course on the modern city, what it has taught me, what kinds of questions have emerged, would be of interest perhaps to at least start off this conversation. As I said, you know, Bangalore's been now welcoming people from all over the country and indeed the world, and there has been an extraordinary interest and growing consciousness about the importance of heritage in particular. So finally, I would say that Bangalore has acquired a history. Most of it is a history pertaining to the colonial period, but much of it is pre-colonial as well. And here I want to make a small correction to what you began by saying, Arumar, which is that this city in particular is divided between English and Kannada, and the two very rarely meet. But I have to tell you, there has been actually quite a lot of writing in Kannada. And I'm going to cite the work of one such historian, S.K. Aruni. Most of the writing that I'm referring to is talking of monumental structures that have survived, such as temples, the mosques, dargahs, many of them, of course, as you can see, are places of worship, as well as the fort, armories, remnants of palaces, etc. Now, this public interest in the city's history is, as I said, expressing itself in terms of producing shelves and shelves of books. But they also are complemented by the interest of daily newspapers, neighborhood walks, heritage clubs, projects such as the ones. There is a wonderful exhibition of maps on display upstairs. I urge you all to go up and have a look at it once you've done with hearing what we have to say. So this desperate desire for history reminds me of what Bankim Chandra said in the 19th century, despairing about colonial rule, when he said, "We don't have a history, we must have a history." That is to say, a history written by Indians themselves. And it is here that I want to say this idea of historylessness, which somehow has been seen as something of a burden in a city like Bangalore, was actually seen as a privilege in 1962 when Nehru came to Bangalore and addressed members of the Municipal Council. And I'd like to just read that short paragraph to emphasize the irony of his words. This is what he said. "Most of the cities of India remind one certainly of the present, certainly of the future, but essentially of the past. But Bangalore, as I said, more than any other great cities of India, is a picture of India of the future. More specifically, because of the concentration of science, technology, and industries in the public sector here. Most of the old cities represent history, whereas your great city represents the future we are molding. In addition to its representation of the future, it is also one of the most beautiful cities of India." I read this to you only because, of course, it has ended up being, in some ways, the city of the future. And the paradox to which I want to point, as the first point I want to make, is precisely that this extraordinary appetite for understanding, investigating, and documenting Bangalore's history has been matched by an equal indifference to its history. So if you read the book that I was talking about this morning, the Discovering Bangalore book, which is a series of walks which are detailed by Meera Iyer, she does occasionally lament, and she is right, that you know INTAC had to do a lot of excavation, literally, because things were buried under garbage, and you know, things were neglected. There's a lot of dereliction that is afflicting even those few monuments that we have in the city today. But this is where I would like to say that our history, so this paradox between the appetite for history and the neglect of it is something that we need to spend perhaps a few minutes thinking about. In addition to which, and I want to say this right at the outset, we're really not talking about history as only being about documentation of monuments. You know, what are the villages that have come, been absorbed by the city, whose village ways have been sort of taken over, either superseded by urbanism or remained, as it were, a visible identity in the city. Another element of this interest in the city, and here I'm citing the work of S.K. Armi, are the major shifts that take place, which are hinged on those wars for which actually Bangalore was the site. These three major wars. Now, normally we think of battles and wars as a sign of shifting political controls and allegiances, but there is another important set of shifts that take place, and this time what he has pointed to actually is the religious sphere, as kings and leaders and their people shift their allegiance. So from Jainism to Shaivism was one such shift that was occasioned by the wars between the Nolambas and the Gangas way back in 891 AD. the Adil Shahi incursion into Bangalore under Ranadullah Khan in 1638 not only began the influx of the Marathas, interestingly enough, but also Sufi saints who left their imprint, as we all know, in many parts of the city. And then, of course, we have the more recent battle for Bangalore in 1791 that led to the British victory over Tipu in 1799. So I'm saying this because one can accumulate a number of facts related to material traces in the city, but there may be other kinds of shifts which perhaps don't always leave material shifts and material traces, and we need to be somewhat alert to them. This renewed interest in history, as I said, is not matched by this by any kind of plebeian interest in preservation. And instead, what we find is a city that has been overtaken, and I'm sure we'll all be in agreement here, by an increased focus and singular devotion to the functional uses of space and the economic uses of time. This, I think, raises this first question, which I would like to pose, of what value are historical perspectives on city space when they are unencashable, not grounded, as it were, in the logic of real estate. The second question, which a city like Bangalore embodies or represents, is also again related to its past. Now, it was an administrative capital, it was a military encampment, it was a place of not very significant religious importance despite these isolated temple complexes which have now been incorporated in the city. And most importantly, it bypassed smokestack industrialization. So at the time when Bombay, Kanpur, Calcutta, Ahmedabad were being industrialized, largely textile and related industries, this was a very sluggish industrial landscape, very, very sluggish industrial landscape in the late 19th and the early 20th century. It's really only since the 1940s with the emergence of the public sector that you have Bangalore emerging as one city that has an industrial profile. Having said that, I also want to point to one form of production which has perhaps the longest history and longer than maybe even the cities I mentioned a moment ago, and that is textile production in the old city area, which is at least 3 or 4 centuries old. And it is continuous, unbroken tradition of textile production in that area. So that's quite unique as well. But I'm saying this because the city has, of course, today become inextricably linked to industries that are engaged that are engaging immaterial labor, producing immaterial products, the IT and IT-enabled industries, as it were, via, of course, the public sector route in both production on the one hand and in terms of research and development on the other. And today, we are at a unique moment because it is a city which perhaps doesn't always only offer opportunities for employment, but also opportunities for accumulating capital, and I'm here referring to more social and cultural capital of the educational kind, not just for middle class and upper class people, but also for relatively poor people. So so we have layered histories of what Bangalore, and it's all been telescoped into the last 4 or 5 decades. So this is the thing about Bangalore, I think, that is something remarkable, which is practically everything which took a century and a half to happen elsewhere has been somehow telescoped into 4 or 5 decades in this city. So, you know, how do we approach the city less as a place perhaps of work and more as a place that is of accumulation? And an index of these changes, I'll just give you one small index of these changes in terms of how representative democracy reflects these transformations. It might interest some of you to know that we had a left-wing trade unionist representing Rajaji Nagar, M.S. Krishnan in the 1980s, Surinarayan Rao, another left-wing trade unionist representing Warthur in the 1980s. Now, that is of course completely in our past. It's not something that has been, you know, that has remained. So we can no longer claim that Bangalore's MLAs any longer represent working class interests. So there are very significant shifts that have taken place in terms of representations of castes. So, you know, what does that signal really in terms of what interests are represented in our legislative assemblies itself of some concern to us? And while saying this, you know, I don't want to read that part because it's all too long, but I have said in my book that the early plans as well reflected this interest in the working class and in housing the working class. That was a major preoccupation of the earliest town plans for Bangalore. So that tells you the size and importance of this city as a site of production at that time. So I think from this observation of these shifts in the economic profile of the city, we must also reflect on built forms and some of the changes and paradoxes. If we see the city as generative, not just of economic wealth and political power, but of certain civic virtues, what do these shifts in built form reveal to us in terms of shifts in civic virtues? And I think actually we do have some very exciting and interesting examples in Bangalore. One of them, which I have again referred to in my work, is the small settlement called Knoxpet, which now has been renamed as Murphy Town, and then now I think has some other name which I'm not sure of. This was an attempt to actually give chakliyas, that is to say people who made boots for the army, an opportunity for form of self-definition through offering them a settlement that was respectable, well-serviced, and extremely well provided for in terms of open-to-sky spaces. So Murphy Town was an ideal location, and it was a working-class settlement intended entirely for these leather workers for the military. It's an unusual example because it was actually believed that the built form will actually produce some kind of new ideas of self-respect amongst those who saw themselves as lower caste workers of leather and so on and so forth. So that's an interesting experiment that happens. I think another interesting experiment, and I would almost verge on the calling it an element of democracy, is the construction of the so-called plague-proof towns. And I'm referring to, you know, Fraser Town, Cook Town, Cox Town, and so on and so forth, which happened after the plague in Bangalore in 1898. Again, an attempt was made to provide a scale and a style of housing that would be affordable for very ordinary kinds of people. So it was breaking through this colonial elite kind of bungalow construction to much smaller houses, which was affordable to larger groups of people. And finally, my final example from the period I've looked at is of the industrial township. Now, the industrial township, and I think Nehru's little quotation reveals us this intention of, you know, both starting the public sector industries and also provisioning for them in forms of industrial township was to produce new patriotic citizens. And patriotic citizen is a producing citizen, so it's a patriotic producer, really, that we're talking about. The industrial township was intended to engage people in respecting people who came from all over the country, spoke other languages, you know, followed other religions, and lived amicably in these settlements. New forms of citizenship were being envisaged in these very built forms. So I'm saying that there have been some, if we care to look for them, there have been some interesting kinds of experiments from which we may draw out certain lessons for how built form actually generates some kind of new civic virtue. I'm hard-pressed if any of you asks me what that built form might be that produces some kind of new civic virtue in our contemporary Bangalore. I would be really hard-pressed, but I urge you to think along with me on that question. And then this brings me to the second last point I want to make about social justice in the city. I have been returning of late, and I said this to you in my email, to the history of planning in Mysore city. And what struck me about the history of planning, which again is happening in the late 19th and early 20th century, is the extraordinary loyalty of those early planners to ascribed difference. And when I say ascribed difference here, of course, I am referring to the segregations of caste. You will see in these documents related to early planning in Mysore how diligently the planner stuck to representing castes in specific spaces in Mysore. Of course, this was the impetus was making the palace and the royal family safe from plague. So the impetus was a sanitary impetus. But what the effect it has is that an opportunity that planning offers for reimagining space is in some ways lost. So there's something foundationally unequal about the early stages of planning in this country. And this is, I think, also evident if you go up and see some of the maps of Malleshwaram and Basungudi in Bangalore, similarly had great respect for caste divisions. And according to that, space also was designated, that is to say, more space for the upper caste and so on and so forth. This deformation of planning law, what I'm calling a deformation of planning law, at its founding moment was not entirely effaced. It has, however, been secularized. So if one reads data for contemporary Indian cities, the overwhelming proportion of slum dwellers is, of course, are people from the lower castes and from the minorities. So we are facing the same predicament that was faced by the industrial city, the Victorian industrial city in its early stages. Just at the time when we are experiencing the creation of unprecedented wealth, we are also seeing the deepening of inequality. So if the horrors of the Victorian city led to the rudiments of a solution, namely ideas of civic order and planning, in which the state plays a major role, what are the kinds of solutions that the contemporary city offers us? And here I would like to cite one of the greatest sort of early historians of the city, Louis Mumford. He famously spoke about the Victorian city as a disease that produced its own antibodies. I was very struck by that phrase, you know. It was a disease that produced its own antibodies, namely planning. What are the resources, historical resources, with which we can think of alternatives in the contemporary city, especially at a time when, as you know, welfareism has been so thoroughly undermined by the assemblages of governance that are promoted in our times? Now, I'm not getting into the ARP question. There may be questions that come up on ARP. But I'd say just one final thing, and then we'll open it up. I'm sorry I've taken so long. I think finally also that there is a really rich body of research and writing on the Indian city over the last three decades. But at least in one respect, I feel we are at something of an impasse. This relates to this widespread recognition of the failures of planning, and I myself have done this just a moment ago, in addressing crucial questions relating to the more just distribution of resources, but also to the complete failure of law as an instrument for reining in or keeping in check the aggrandizement of city space. Indeed, as we know today, there is speculative overbuilding of a kind that we had not imagined even 10 years ago. And let's recall this too, that it might be the state itself that is violating the law. I think the most spectacular instance of this is the
Rajkalwe story
project, which is happening, unfolding as we speak in Delhi. But rather than subscribing to a more apocalyptic version of the future, a relentless drive towards a planet of slums, what might we retrieve from forms of urbanism that have grown and thrived outside the ambit of the law? I want us to think creatively about our own history and our own history of disrespect and very widespread disrespect for planning law. What might that teach us in terms of what is possible for urbanism? Because perhaps we have exhausted the heroic planning model. we cannot be Singapore. I think that was a dream for a while. Singapore and Shanghai, these were the two kinds of models which were held up as models of heroic planning. I don't think that we can anymore go in that direction, given the kinds of challenges of our own country, particularly given the continuous migration that is happening from the countryside. What does our long history of disrespect for the law teach us about what are possible solutions? I'm not saying I have an answer here. I'm just saying that we have to now start thinking creatively about our own reality. It is not illegality that we are any longer talking about. We're talking about non-legality. So there is legal and then there is the non-legal. I'm not just making a nomenclatural difference here. I'm trying to suggest that we have to have some ways of thinking of what it is that our pushback can be against the models of planning and so on that we have received and which we are all enthralled of, no doubt. But we need to rethink this relationship much more clearly, much more strongly, and much more creatively in order to take the lessons of history forward. So I'll stop there. I just wanted to make these preliminary comments.
Yeah, thanks for laying that out. Just, you know, a few responses to them. The first thing, of course, is that this is an exceptional city in many ways. It's very rare in the world today, even with the kind of energy and resources we have, to find a megacity emerging in this context. It's a plateau city. The only few other places that are like this are Mexico City, Addis Ababa, a couple of cities in China. So in some senses, to have a city of 10 million people here, kind of unimaginable to people who were born here in the 40s, 50s and 60s, that you'd ever imagine something that will become so large. So this is a huge anomaly. The second thing is that within the state itself, unlike many other cities in India, it is a city of tremendous primacy. I mean, you know, it has the bulk of the population of urban population in Karnataka. It basically brings together, like you said, much of the wealth that the state has. If Bangalore sort of has an economic recession, it impacts the state. So massive concentration of wealth and people in one particular place. And in some senses, of course, there's a history to it. This isn't the borderland between many different disjuncts and empires in some senses, and it's an interesting place that this will emerge. But I'm just wondering, given the sort of history of this region, of course you have a precedence of Hampi. Hampi was an exceptional city of its time, one of the really exceptional cities of a few centuries in some senses, both for this subcontinent and in the world in some ways. Hampi had similar attributes. It was next to a river, but they hardly used the water from the river. So this city is fundamentally constrained because it's sitting at the plateau, it's drawing its water from the Kaveri, and if that water didn't come here, the city actually in many effects would not exist. And then you have, like you said, this back and forth. You know, we forget the Jain history of this region, and Buddhist history, which is very strong. And it's kind of almost sort of forgotten in the landscape. But Adil Shahi is, of course, one part of that process. But the Marathas, if you look at the linguistic structure of the city, this is a very very cosmopolitan city, more than many other cities in India. You look at the number of languages that are spoken, you can, in a sense, see the comings and goings of people, including Marathi-speaking populations, populations that speak many other languages apart from Kannada, various forms of, let's say, Dakani, Urdu, etc. So in that sense, the back and forth of that is contained in the cultural fabric of the city. The question I have is, what kind of imaginaries would we be seeing both in our past and our future that we're dealing with? You've dealt with one, which is Nehru. There's also Vishwesharaya, who's a little bit before that and is very, very important in defining how Mysore developed in some senses, or what the future of Bangalore was. If he was not able to industrialize Mysore, produce the electricity that we had there, you know, many of the things that were possible in Bangalore in the 40s, 50s and 60s may not have been possible. So I think the question that, one of the core questions that we're having today is, are we able to look back and then look at that for imaginaries, including the imaginary of the unequal city that's defined by Vastu and sort of caste hierarchies? Or are we able to look at a different future, which is neither Shanghai nor Singapore? And where will the roots for that actually sit in this context? Is there a root in, you know, in Karnataka culture? Is there a root in other forms of culture? Is there a root in sort of in Indian sort of modernity? that you might see some connections with, because I think the challenge that we have today with a city of 10 million going to maybe 15 is we are captured by many other circuits. If you look at where the airport and where Electronic City is set out, in a sense the circuits of the global city are driving what could actually happen here, both in terms of economic process and cultural, whatever it is. So do you see any sort of any connections that we can draw from the past, any contradictions that are still got to be resolved, some sort of hope that we may have to deal with the imagination of Saskia Sassen at one end, which has many challenges, the imagination of the Singapore, the Shanghai, the Dubai, which many of our political leaders are hanging on to, or the Nehruvian utopia, which has not even found fruit in, let's say, Chandigarh, which we work on a lot. Exactly. So, you know, are there some contours that you'd want to explore in that place for the city? Because,
you know, I'm going to answer this question in a slightly roundabout way. And that is to talk about one of the things that I have been very interested in while teaching this course of the modern city. And that is the relative absence in our Indian setting of ideas of utopia. We don't have so many dreamers. Even Gandhi, who wrote on practically everything, did not really put his mind to reimagining space. So we don't have the kind of responses, even fantastic responses, I'm not saying they should be realistic responses, to the problems that were faced either in the colonial period or later. In fact, what we have is a long history of series of accommodations between what might have been a plan and what was eventually transpiring on the ground. So I'm not sure whether history and thinking within this country is necessarily going to be, a resource. You can literally count on the fingers of one hand, maybe Shantiniketan had some sort of idea of incorporating the rural with the urban in a way that imitates Ebenezer Howard's Garden City, perhaps. Orwell is maybe another example of something more utopian, but those are really small, very fragmentary, and perhaps not, as you say, appropriate responses for something that's turning out to be this huge sort of megacity here. I think our examples perhaps have to be drawn from other countries in the world, and I'm giving at least one instance of, for example, transportation. Can we have a model taken from places like Curitiba, where there is an insistence on the use of public transport? Now, I'm saying insistence because, again, I'm falling back on the instruments of law. Without that kind of insistence, I think we will not see a shift away, for example, from the use of private vehicles to public transport. So even if we have a very fine metro system, as is the case in Delhi, we will not necessarily see a shift away from the use of private transport to public transport in a hurry. So we have to have something really fairly drastic that looks at the city. And as you say, the water resources of the city are extremely limited. There was a time when it was self-sufficient, when we relied on the tank system. And I urge you again to go upstairs and look at our maps up there, because they really reveal to you what Bangalore relied on before Kaveri stage 1, 2, 3 and 4 have come bringing water from 125 kilometers away uphill to 3,000 feet. So it's unsustainable. It's not going to sustain that kind of. We have to think of much more piecemeal local kinds of solutions. There was a plan as early as the late 19th century to revive the tanks of Mysore. But that sort of fell by the wayside. And it was actually, I have to say, you know, I mean, at the risk of sounding slightly disloyal to him, Visheshwaraya had this imagination of big is beautiful. So for him, everything was going to be industrialized or perish, as you said, but also big is beautiful. So, you know, it had to be dam and hydroelectric. But that was the moment. We cannot blame him for thinking that way, because that was the moment which was actually seeing development as happening in this large scale major way, and of course it made a difference to farming in Mandya and so on and so forth. But the point I'm trying to make is we have to now break this down. We have to think in terms of smaller scale solutions. And you know, we have to have some ways of saying that the law has perhaps to play some kind of penal role. I'm saying this coming straight from the experience of odd even in Delhi. The first year that odd even was implemented, there was a lot of grumbling. There were people who were saying, I'm going to go out and buy a second car so that I can stay on both the odd and the even side of this equation. The second time it was implemented, the fines were higher and people were a little more accommodative. But I can tell you the last time, which was last year, people actually welcomed it. And there was a sense that if we don't act together, then this whole story is lost. It's not just for the poor that the story of clean air is going to be lost, but it's going to be lost for everybody as well. So I don't have a direct answer for what resources we have. We have to look at international examples of a different kind, not Shanghai and Singapore so much, but these much smaller examples of Curitiba, and I'm sure you know many more of them. I'm aware of Curitiba and some other locations where this works. So how does one arrive at some kind of consensus on what is good for, what is the good city form? A good city form is not necessarily this big city form with more and more lines being laid out to connect, you know, really distant places. What is this good city form? I think we really have to spend a lot of time thinking about it and maybe think creatively even in ways that are not practicable in order to arrive at that which is practical.
So that's one core question. The other question that you touched on was the question of structural inequality. You know, we think of, let's say, South Africa as a place that practiced apartheid. And it's very true, you know, now 25 years after the transition, you still see apartheid alive in Johannesburg and in Cape Town and other cities like that. But in actual fact, if you look at our cities, including this one, you do find very strong elements of those inequalities burnt into the fabric. Whether it was in the earlier imagination and design, and Vastu has elements of that, in the 19th century thing which brought together, you know, the sanitary view of the world, of course it helped the British in some senses to be able to segregate and stuff like that, but we were able to bring together these two elite kind of views of things and in a sense burn it into the structure of the city. Now, you know, one of the views of Bangalore is it's a city that does not have too much inequality. Because effectively the proportion of, let's say, people living in slums and informal settlements, badly sort of measured, is less than a city like Mumbai or Kolkata, etc., etc. But in actual fact, inequality is burnt into the fabric of this city. So I guess one of the other questions is, yes, you can, you know, look at other examples from other parts of the world, but you have to address the question of inequality in social structure and gender questions, etc., in your own context. You can't find solutions that come from another culture because they will not have a root here. So, you know, where do you see the answers for that coming? Do you see any movements and processes either in the 19th or the 20th century within the city or otherwise that give us some hope that we will start seeing a little bit, you know, some changes here? Or, you know, are we continuously trapped now moving from, you know, the Basavangudi and Malleswaram to some fancy high-rise apartments which are inside sort of gated communities? That's a 21st century version of the same thing. Yeah.
I agree with you, and I have no disagreement on this question at all. The only thing I would like to say by way of a response is that we have to see, and this may seem like a slightly old-fashioned thing to say, but a much larger role to be played by the state. Because I think what has happened, especially since the 1980s, is that the market is increasingly playing a very large role, and it is not having the kind of equalizing effect that you would imagine markets should have. In fact, if anything, it's only exacerbated inequality, as you say. There are these gated communities. This is not specific to Bangalore, of course. This is true of almost every Indian city, because what is on offer in these gated communities is the idea of planning itself. So while planning has failed on a citywide scale, it is planning that is being offered to people in these gated communities. So you have 24-hour water and electricity and all these security and so on and so forth in these micro regions, which are only affordable to certain classes of people. I do not see any way other than a role for the state. I do not see the market performing this role, because you do not have any historical example in the world where the market has performed this role of equalizing or of distributing resources in some way that is more just. I think a just city will require much more state intervention. Are we already past that stage? I don't know. I mean, this is something that perhaps people should be demanding in ways that makes it possible. On the question of people's movements and so on, again, I'm not sure that we have examples other than very small ones of people's movements making a difference to the broader sort of fabric, to the broader sort of setting of inequality. So, I'm afraid that the dystopic vision of people like Mike Davis in Planet of Slums is, compelling. We don't have very direct kind of alternatives, utopian alternatives to that, unless we can pressurize, I think, the state to take a greater role. Now, whether we are past that moment, as I say, to repeat myself, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I mean, the thing, of course, is that Bangalore has tried to plan. In some senses, the plans have both been effective and completely ineffective at one end, whether it was the previous master plan or the current one that's there, because the city is growing at such a rapid rate. And in some senses, I think the deepest inequality is situated inside the land market. And that's the one that in which there's the most, innovation, because in effect, that's the engine that drives most political processes and most political parties. So there's no interest in actually controlling that, because otherwise the political system will start to break down. That's where the rents are made and stuff like that. But I guess one of the other questions that's tied to both inequality and the urban form is, where are people going to get new jobs from? Where are the new livelihoods going to come from? And you talked about Bangalore being very special. It has a long history of textiles in the past. Silk being, this is one of the major regions in the world in which silk was produced. Tremendous amount of innovation in this place, and you can see it all the way from the older parts of the city to Ramanagara, etc., that you can see. But then, in some senses, because of its location, unable to become an industrial hub, even in spite of Visveshwaraya. He did want to try and industrialize, but the industries that came were light industries, partially because the Second World War brought certain things in and stuff like that. And then we made this great leap into IT and BT and other such stuff that's there. But the fact is that this state has a large number of young people. Many of them, because of agrarian distress in Hyderabad, Karnataka, etc., do need to find alternative forms of livelihood. And, is it the new gig economy, people running around on motorcycles, taking food to other people, that's going to provide this kind of stuff? What kind of imaginations do we see ourselves working out? And what are the structural factors that we can see inside the city that give us some hope that things could actually be different? Because we know that the high-end economy, the froth economy in some senses, is doing very well, both for India and for the city, partially because it's very far from Delhi, but also because there's been tremendous enterprise. But the fact is that's not going to give you, the millions of livelihood opportunities that we need. And you now have a situation where you have a large number of educational institutions just now, like engineering colleges and things like that, which are not able to fill their seats because, the prospects are not very good. So the question of urban structure and how the changing nature of work will play itself out is something that might be interesting, and the state has a role in it, but maybe the other ways of looking at it too. So maybe you have some thoughts on that.
I think that you've raised a very important question related to work in the city, and I think we have to rethink the idea of work. Can you hear me? I said we have to rethink the idea of work. You have yourself used the term gig economy. It is the dominant mode of livelihood for most of those who are now migrating into the city. Impermanent jobs, insecure jobs. We are having the growth of a large precarious. So we have to rethink ideas of work. That's a fact. The old secure public sector job, we have interviewed people who used to work in BEL, and they now look back and rue the fact that but they as a union often fought for very irrelevant minor privileges, because what is at stake now is the idea of work itself, and what is being redefined is the idea of work. We will also have to think increasingly about what people do outside of work, and you know, whether there are things that can constructively engage people in community activities and not perhaps in the kinds of activities we are seeing increasingly on our streets today, but the kinds of activities which rebuild communities at a time when these new technologies, modes of social media communications and so on and so forth, are increasingly alienating people from the kinds of public engagements that would have been true even 20 or 30 years ago. So how do we bring back the idea of face-to-face communities, community revival, renewal and so on and so forth, which perhaps is not necessarily tied to ideas of work? I think that we will have to disaggregate these questions a little bit. I'm not sure whether this is speaking in some sort of idealistic manner, but I think there is no other choice, because we are going to see increasingly that people are going to exploit themselves in the gig economy, either working 24 hours a day to make ends meet, or they will be laid off and enjoying large periods of leisure, for which we have to find some kind of creative kind of activity that renews, as it were, the city. So I don't see the hope of well-paid, secure, long-term jobs ever coming back. I think that moment is past, that's behind us. And that's true even of the profession from which I come, namely teachers. Even teachers are now increasingly coming on to contract systems. So, it's like every field of economic activity is being affected by the precarious nature of work. So we have to rethink work and the relationship between work and leisure in very creative ways. Or at least we have to maybe rename leisure, non-work time as leisure. It maybe that's the wrong term to use for it, that non-work time has to be redesigned to think about it in terms of what we put back into communities. Not necessarily be paid for it, but perhaps do something meaningful. But how will that happen? I'm not sure who's going to organize it. I'm not even sure that here even the state is of
much use.
Renew ourselves as communities, urban communities, return to public spaces, participate in certain kinds of community activities. I think you're doing a great job of bringing people together for certain kinds of activities and more such things to happen. So this is one. Yeah. And I think that we have to start young. So, I would say we have to start even in schools and in colleges on how to rethink this relationship between work and non-work time and how one might creatively deploy these times.
That's a very deeply challenging thought, because, a generation came to Bangalore or grew up here because it had BL and HMT and, HAL and stuff like that. So you could bring the high tech and whatever it is. Then a new generation came here in the 90s and the 2000s because all the high-tech industry, the IT industry was here. And that was, in a sense, the new place that you could find new jobs, new ways of doing things. But now we're saying, look, even that is going to be even more precarious in the future. So where can you find that? And I think one thing, before we open up the discussion is, how do you view the situation of women and gender in this new city? And what is the connection between the struggles of the past, the 60s, 70s and 80s, and the new struggles that we're emerging just now? Because the city in some senses is a little bit different from others. It's a little bit more gentle, but it still has some of those deeper elements of patriarchy again burnt into the fabric and structure. Do you see that sort of shifting at all? Do we see some hope for changes in that, in the nature of work, in the nature of social relations, in the nature of the way that public life is being, or protest is being organized?
I think this is, I'm a pessimist by nature, I have to confess, but this is one sphere where I feel much more optimistic for two or three reasons. One, because I see larger and larger numbers of women in the workplace. however endangered their jobs might be, starting with garment workers, all the way, and you know, some have been completely dismantled. Factories like HMT and watch production and so on and so forth have been completely dismantled. But women have been out there, particularly in a city like ours, have been vocal and very, you know, united in their demand for better working conditions. There's a long history of this. It's a little bit under the radar because not enough work has been done on those kinds of struggles in the past. But I think what we're witnessing today is also a much more in-your-face kind of sedimentation of Indian feminism in a way that's making young people very sort of bold, willing to take risks, and we've seen this in the past, just in the past week, of a kind that is unimaginable. So there is a certain kind of assertion that is happening in public life. So I'm not going in the direction of saying that the violence against women has in any way dimmed or lessened. I would say, in fact, that the violence against women is a form of a backlash against precisely the visibility, the increased visibility and assertion of women. So in that sense, I don't want to sound like I'm endorsing violence, but I'm saying that this is clearly a sign that it has posed a threat to existing orders, and I think this is one sphere in which I'm actually very optimistic, that this is one sphere of life which is perhaps not so easy to redraw by those who are envisaging this new India. Because women are out there, they're in all areas of work, they're entrepreneurs, they're workers in factories, they're in the gig economy, they're doing all kinds of things which would have been unimaginable earlier, but they're also become politically assertive in a way that is very promising, in my view. And we're seeing this in many parts of India, not just in Bangalore. So I am very optimistic about the fact that, you know, this is going to be a long struggle. It's not going to change in a very short period of time. But thus, the visibility of women, the occupation of public space by women is actually going to make a very big difference to the future of, you know, gender relations as a whole in the city.
Good. So I thought, just, you know, that open up for questions, you know, responses. Anything you'd like to say, ask Janaki. Yeah, there are mics, so. Go ahead.
Hello, hi. Myself, Puneet. It's probably slightly related to this topic, or mainly my clarification of some certain things. Apart from the financial capital, like all the other types of capital, like intellectual capital or social capital, is all used as a means to end, to gain the financial capital. Like, how will we, you know, as like in the education system, include to value intellectual capital as itself the end and not the means to attain financial capital?
Okay, good. Let's bring together 2-3 questions and maybe Janaki can respond. Yeah, I think you just press the thing, it should come on. It's voice activated, so you can just go ahead. Yeah.
Hi. You know,
can you just introduce yourself, please? Sorry.
I'm Krishna Kumar.
Yes.
I had two points to seek clarification on. One is, you know, when you talk of the history of cities in India and so on, don't you feel that it ought to be underpinned in how the economy and how the society has also evolved? To me, it seems, I'm not a historian or even a serious student of history, it seems to me that the fundamental shift that happened in the late 80s or 90s of our economy transitioning from an industrial, agro-industrial economy to a services economy, and the future being triggered and driven by the services sector, I think that underlies or underpins this whole thing. So how do we factor that in prospective historical studies? This is one. And related to this is the fact that you also said about you know, Nehru's speech in the Bangalore City Council and so on, and the public sector undertakings and their townships. Now, today it seems to me that particularly with the services sector coming in and dominating the economy and its growth and trajectory, new externalities and much deeper and stronger externalities are being created. Earlier, for instance, when you set up those townships in Jalali and so on, you at once solve the housing problem, you solve the transport problem, because they ran their own buses and so on. So today, the IT sector, for all its achievements and so on, has created that externality and passed it on to the city government and the state government. Is taxation alone and a stronger state, as you advocate, is that the answer? Or should there also be a sense of ownership of this externality and some kind of a compensatory approaches by the IT sector or whatever is the leads?
Another question, the third one. Somebody wants to, yeah, somebody at the back, please. Yeah, here, here, here. Yeah, you're live.
Hello. Since I have been witness as well as a participant in some of the events that you described.
Can you introduce yourself, please?
Sorry.
Can you introduce yourself? Yeah.
My name is E.P. Menon. You mentioned about an utopian dream of Nehru. I haven't participated in that. When Governor Giri was here, and 1961, this particular area was the place for the Indian National Congress session. 60-61 period. After the Congress session, Nehru had a public reception in the Raj Bhavan. And one idea many people in Bangalore, especially voluntary people, came forward with was children in Bangalore should be the best treated. So an organization came up, Sarva Shishu Poshan Sangha. Sarva Shishu Poshan Sangha. And Nehru inaugurated it. We had a big dinner and all that. So that is one of the utopian ideas Bangalore had at that time. Many other plus points you mentioned, but there are some minor points also. One of the important minor points I can see is why the public sector institutions in Bangalore deteriorated. This is a collective question we all have to think about. Many important things have happened, good. But I think public sector Bangalore had a very special place for. Second, educational institutions have come up, many, science, etc. Then now ITBT, all these are the plus point. But on the whole, there is a great deal of unrest in Bangalore now. So how do we reconcile with the dreams Nehru had? Then Jeevara Jalwa and Ramesh Hegde had several good dreams here, and they did a lot of work. Then came S.M. Krishna with a dream. Bangalore should be like Singapore, the cleanest city in the country. What happened to it now? So we need to question all these things together in a way, how do we move forward? So what can be the answer?
So you've got a set of very provocative questions.
Let me answer my young friend here. I think you've raised a very important question. And I want to actually draw on the work of Thomas Piketty in order to answer your question, because Piketty has in his book Capital in the 21st Century actually talked about this disjunct between education and social mobility. He says, whereas education had been seen as the route to social and economic mobility earlier, there is no longer a guarantee that your degree is going to yield some kind of better social or economic life. And that is true. We know this for a fact because of the oversupply, as it were. I mean, you spoke about engineering, but this is the oversupply of educated people generally. And it's not only particular to India. It's what he is talking about is something that is an international phenomenon, that the investment in education, and especially higher education, he is referring largely to higher education, is not necessarily yielding the same results that were yielded even 20 years ago. The hope that I'm sorry, I don't want to sound discouraging here, but we have to be practical and realistic, the hope that a degree will lead to a greater financial or economic or even social position is not necessarily a hope that is borne out in the contemporary period, partly because of the nature of this change in the economy. which brings me to your question. So, you know, in terms of pursuing education for its own sake and for the sake of doing something else, here again you have to massively rethink how education has been organized. And that's why I said even this thinking, what is community and community work and renewal and so on, has to perhaps happen at the school and college level before long. We'll have to have some very creative interventions from the state itself in order to enter that field of thinking, as it were. But this is related to what you said about the shift between the shift from conventional industrial activity to the service sector, which is quite right, and we don't know what this next stage is going to be. I sometimes show my students I regret to say, a somewhat pessimistic video. It's called Humans Need Not Apply, and it's a small 10-minute video. You can watch it, those of you who are interested. But it's basically predicting a world which will have no work for human beings, because practically every realm of human activity, including creative activity such as the composition of music and so on, will be taken over by artificial intelligence. Now, that's again an extreme kind of vision that is being portrayed in that video. But it's worth thinking about, because it is true that many kinds of jobs and work has been rendered obsolescent. How do we prepare for this obsolescence? This is why I'm saying we really have to rethink the meaning and nature of work, and what work is, and whether work is going to be only for sustaining oneself and one's family, or whether work has to be seen in some other way. I'm saying something which is probably sounding bizarre to many of you, but I think we have reached that stage where we need to rethink that relationship. There is no alternative, because this idea of work as something that you do in order to make your ends meet and to run your families and homes and so on and so forth may have to be given up in favor of, say, something like basic income, and then, you know, making an argument for more creative work to be engaged in by people with that guarantee of the basic kind of sustenance for one's life, for creative, meaningful and sustainable life, as it were. So I don't have a direct answer to what you're saying of what the future holds for us. As I said, most of the, it's very easy to imagine dystopias. This is the other thing about the city. It is much easier to imagine the dystopia, and there are very vivid pictures and imaginations about dystopia than there are about utopic answers of the city, to the problems of the city. But so, and this has been, look up some of the examples and you will see that I'm quite right. So in some ways I'm repeating that. I'm saying to you that there is a much more rich account of a dystopic world that is unfolding around us than we have of answers, creative answers to, of the utopian kind. We just don't have enough thinking of that kind. And it's much more difficult to think that way. Let's put it like that, because we don't know who will be responsible for that kind of thinking and that kind of solution, as it were, to some of the problems with which we are faced.
Good. I think, thank you so much. Yeah.
Sorry, there's one more question from one of our live stream viewers. It says, Professor Nair has also written extensively on public history. I want to ask what her perceptions are on the growth of public history in Bangalore. Has city space entered into public consciousness in your view? By this I mean histories of neighborhoods, water bodies, as they get lost or are revived. And if yes, what is the point of this history and what work does it do?
Oh, that's a nice question. Yes, as I said, this relates to the earlier part of what I began by saying, which is there is no doubt at all that there is extraordinary interest in local history. And in fact, one of the questions which came up this morning as well is why the neighborhood is a very meaningful place to start for tracking these histories. I would place neighborhood history on a different kind of register from public history. I think public history is broader, and certainly that too seems to be taking off. Except having said that, I should say that the professional historian, people such as myself with very few kinds of skills, are perhaps the most irrelevant people in India today because the field of history has in some ways been taken over by a large number of amateurs. I'm speaking both positively and negatively about this phenomenon. A very small corner of that field is occupied by professional historians, and that's, I think, a good thing that there is so much popular interest in history. It's when it goes in the direction of making claims that are a bit unsustainable, either in terms of you know, archival material or in terms of historical memory, that we have some difficulties. But to get more directly to the question that has been asked, has the city figured in the imagination of public histories? I would say to the extent that the city is interesting larger and larger numbers of people, but I think the way in which the city is interesting larger and larger numbers of people is in terms of more and more information about the neighborhoods. You know, who's in whose name has this road being named, and who, you know, who was the architect of this particular building, what is the so it's that level of informational knowledge that is most expanded, I would say. The other questions which I pointed to in the few comments I made in terms of what is the meaning of the space in terms of generating other kinds of ideas of civic virtue and so on, which might lead us in the direction of asking slightly uncomfortable questions and perhaps getting answers that unsettle us. There's less of that happening in the public sphere. So it's at the moment, I would say, at a very celebratory stage. We want information about places we live in. We want to celebrate that history. We want to know. So it's a great men's version of history, if you like. You know, people who constructed places, ran shops, named streets, whose statues are up here, and so on and so forth.
Last question. We'll have to close now. Yeah. Oh, there were two hands up. Wow. Okay. Forest of hands, come. Okay, go for
so,
it quickly.
Yeah, sorry. So recently, the universities have played a very important role in shaping the public sphere in like cities and things like that, and then also bringing out people like not just students but also women, and create in especially the moment we're in, the political moment, it's played a big role. So now that universities are changing and there's privatization and like even the teacher workforce is getting contractualized, how do we then preserve, I mean, think of the university in the city, and also how do we preserve such a moment that's happening right now because of things like students and university? Like, how do we think about that?
Good, okay. You had somebody else? Yeah, go ahead. Just in front of you. Yeah.
Good afternoon. My name is Adarsh. Earlier in the talk, ma'am, you spoke about how Bangalore is one of the few plateau cities, very rare example among other cities that have, among other cities that have had a history of, let's say, a few hundred years. You spoke of the tanks that were built by Kempe Gowda and his you know, successive generations, and the town planning that was executed by the founders of the city. Do you think in the last few decades, whatever good work was done in the early part of the last century or so, that has probably not been followed up well by the in the last 20, 30 years? Just your views on that.
Okay, there was somebody, last person at the back there. We're kind of running out of time.
Hi, this is Anusha. So, ma'am, you had earlier, I think, spoken about how the way Bangalore is developing, I think state has a larger role to play. And the way the market is driving us, it's probably failing us in a way. But state also has its own incentives, right? So how do we then, is there scope for some public leadership? In which case, how do you, what are the tools that we have to sort of increase such leadership from the public?
Okay, I can't say that I will be able to satisfactorily answer these questions. On the university-city link, I think that's an interesting question that you have raised. But we are at a moment which has already seen a shift away from the public university. I come from one such beleaguered space, so I can speak with very intimate knowledge of this process. The public university is being besieged, and its place is definitely being taken by the private university, both in terms of the numbers. The number of public universities is declining. So whether your question was with reference to the public university and its link to the city, or whether universities as a whole is a question in itself. Now, let me stick to the public university, because I think they have had a very formative role in shaping the space of the city. For example, Bangalore University became a magnet for students from rural Karnataka. It was an opportunity for not only residing in the city, but also finding themselves in education. But we are talking about that moment, which our friend here referred to, when education was still yielding that kind of result of being able to ensure you social and economic mobility. And certainly Bangalore University's hostels played a very major role in allowing people to redefine themselves socially and economically in this extremely unequal. So, you know, coming back to the question of where inequality has been addressed, the university is the ideal space where not only gender representation has been brilliant, and in fact it is probably the only space where gender representation is so equal, but it has also given people of lower castes an opportunity for not only residing in the city and being part of city life, but also defining themselves in ways that lead them to lead much more fulfilled, better and higher quality kinds of lives. So that's my short answer, but that the bigger picture is of course the movement away from the public university. Certainly the private university is not doing any of these things. It's not giving people opportunities for self-definition or any of these things. It's only those who can pay who can afford the private university. So that's a different kind of logic. On this question of planning, you know, I'm not in favor. I think we have to get out of this. I myself indulged in it, but I would like to say, let's not get into this declensionist narrative that somewhere things were working and now they're not working. There are, as I said to you, giving my Mysore example, some very deep inequalities that were woven into the inaugural moment itself. Even the inaugural moment of planning was in some ways deformed. But I did give you an example vis-a-vis Bangalore of the time when working class and industrial housing was taken extremely seriously. That is no longer the case. So, you know, at least there are some sort of brilliant patches, one can say, in this planning history, which we need to somehow seize hold of. And as I say, and I'm repeating myself here, but as I say, I think nothing less than the state can engage in that kind of equalizing measure. It cannot be the market. We don't have any historical examples of the market actually equalizing the field. The last question was again to do with the relationship between state and market. Am I correct? And whether there is a chance of leadership. Now that is really a question I cannot answer. Because it's not going to be some charismatic leader who is going to take us out of this current morass. We are seeing where charismatic leaders are taking us. Let me say no more about this. So, you know, we need some kind of functioning creative community democracy rather than some kind of authoritarian figure who can perhaps lead us out of this. So it has to happen, as I keep saying, these conversations have to begin at the school level, at the high school level at least, and definitely at the college level for it to be yielding some fruit. It's not going to happen in a hurry, it's not going to happen overnight, and we have to take, I think, our examples from anywhere in the world where alternatives have worked. So that's my short answer.
Good. So thank you very much. Thanks for being a wonderful audience. And if you can just thank Janaki, we're nice having you here.